April 27, 1998, I'm talking with Gocho Chakalov, G-O-C-H-O-C-H-A-K-A-L-O-V. The interviewer is Elizabeth Pozzitana, E-L-I-S-A-B-E-T-H, P-O-Z-Z-I-T-H-A-N-N-E-R. We're in New York in the United States of America, and the language is English. April 27, 1998, I'm talking with Mr. Gocho Chakalov. My name is Elizabeth Pozzitana. We're in New York in the United States of America, and the language of this interview is going to be English. Mr. Chakalov, please tell me your exact first and last name and your date of birth.
Yes, my first name is Gocho, and second name is Chakalov, and my date of birth is the 9th of February, 1919. The place of birth is a township close to the Black Sea town of Varna, which might be more familiar. It is called Kavarna, in a region called Dobruja.
How far away is that from Sofia?
That is, as the bird flies, it is 370 kilometers. In miles, that would make about 250 miles.
What memories do you have from living there? What kind of place was it that you grew up at?
See, the place where I was born, the town of Kavarna, was, as my birthday suggests, that was a place which Bulgarian families, quite a few Bulgarian families, had to leave at the end of the First World War, because that part of Bulgaria, which I call Dobruja, that's how it is known, was ceded to Romania. Although that was one of the unfair things done at the end of the First World War, although there were no Romanian graves in this part of Bulgaria, let alone the Romanian population. And this, to a large extent, determined the trend of my life as a fugitive from one's birthplace. So we lived in the town of Varna. That's where my childhood dates back to, which is close to my native town. We could perfectly see it on the other side of a big gulf, and that was something which worked on the consciousness of a young man. There is your birthplace occupied by a foreign power. This accounts for some of the maybe bizarre things I did in my life.
How long had your family been living in your town of birth?
They stem from that town. And the family to which I belong, lived there for several years before that. I mean, my father, who was a physician, he went to that town and married my mother. So the family of my father and mother lived there for several years as a family. And then they had to leave.
What name had your father? What was your father's name?
My father's name was George, precisely George.
Where was he born?
He was born in another town of Bulgaria, Samokov, which is near to Sofia, not very far from Sofia. And he was educated in the United States, in America. He graduated from the Medical School of Pennsylvania in 1895, and then came back to Bulgaria and had the good luck to settle in the town of my mother and marry my mother.
Whose name was?
Whose name was Neda, N-E-D-A.
And what was her maiden name?
Her maiden name was Gocheva, G-O-C-H-E-V-A. My Christian name, Gocho, is linked to the family name Gocheva or Gochev. And our family names are derivatives of Christian names in the possessive case. So, Gochev or Gocheva means the son of Gocho. That is how we form our family names. And this accounts for the similarity between my mother's maiden name, Gocheva, and my name, Gocho.
What religious background did your family have?
The family belongs to what is not very accurately called Greek Orthodox Church, Greek Orthodox denomination. If we say only Orthodox denomination, that might imply that this is the Orthodox denomination. No, it is. It's part of Christendom, so the Eastern Orthodox Church. I don't think I should go into details about the specificities of this, but it is too much hampered by formalities, unfortunately.
How come that your father went to the United States to study medicine? What made him go to the United States?
You see, one very typical feature of Bulgaria are the numerous missionary American schools in the country, which operated, some of them, even 50 years before Bulgaria was liberated from Ottoman oppression, from Turkish, what we loosely call the Turkish yoke. My father.
And this liberation you are referring to happened when?
Happened in 1878. So my father attended an American high school or college in his native town of Samokov, which was a very good educational institution, partly missionary, partly secular, if you might so call it.
What kind of missionaries were they, do you know?
It was not a school run by a particular mission, but there were individual missionaries who worked there as teachers. It was only partly missionary. As a matter of fact, it was a normal secular school and a very high standing. And upon graduation from that school, he went to study in the United States, made his way through college, through university, became a doctor in 1895. But somehow or other, he did not begin thinking of himself as an American, so he returned to Bulgaria.
this schools, the school that you are referring to, that your father went to, who financed that school?
It was financed by current donations collected by the teachers and the president of the school, who during the summer vacations went back to the States and addressed charities, rich people, to donate for this wonderful school. It was privately financed to a large extent.
Which denominations did these missionaries represent?
Practically all were Methodists, practically all of them. There were some Baptists as well.
Did your father, was your father influenced, you think, by?
See, these missionaries, much like later on when I went to the same college, when my sister went to the same college, were very careful in respecting the Orthodox denomination, the Orthodox faith. And they never tried to influence and to convert people into evangelism or Protestantism. They never did that, never did they attempt to do such a thing. What they were after was to instill in the young Bulgarians the Christian faith in its purest form. And in this manner, of course, even yesterday, it was Sunday, even at my age, I was looking for a Protestant church to go to. So they created a very liberal attitude in the young people whom they trained.
Who were the students who attended these schools? From what kind of background did they come from?
Well, originally in the Samokov American school, that was the school which existed even before Bulgaria's liberation, they were from what is loosely called middle-class families. There were no financial difficulties facing the families sending their children to this school. As I told you, the teachers of the schools went to the United States during the summer vacations, and they usually came back with their bags full, so to speak, of charity aid. The students nevertheless belonged to the fairly upper middle class families, because these were the educated and the successful families, the families that knew what their children would get from an American school and who had the good judgment to send their children there. So this was a self-formed elite, not very high elite, but it belonged, as I said, to the upper middle class.
Did you need any kind of test or application process to be taken by those schools?
It all depended on just how many people applied for enlisting in the school, and there were years when they were about as many as could be accepted, but on other occasions there were what we call admission examinations, screening examinations. One very, very good thing is that even when there were when tuition had to be paid. There was a very large number of scholarship students. I was one of them. Depending on sufficiently high grades and good performance, you had to pay nothing.
The students that attended the school, were they all Christians? How was it when you went there?
I was thinking of whether there were any Muslims. No, Christians and Jews.
In terms of a percentage, do you know how?
Yes,
how
in terms of percentage, the Jews were of a much higher percentage than the whole population of Bulgaria. For the simple reason that the Jews were the part of the town population. And the town population was only one-fifth of Bulgaria's population. So that's why, in terms of the entire Bulgarian population, the Jews were of a higher percentage. And since, normally, a large part of the Jews belonged, I don't say all, unlike in other countries, belonged to the upper middle class, we had yet another increase in the in the relative percentage of Jews in the schools. And just to add that these schools were also excellent schooling of life together of people of different religious denominations. We learned how to respect one another.
How, for example, what happened when, in terms of religious education, how did the school handle that?
The Jews did not in the very least object to studying religion in terms of Christian religion. After all, not only the Old Testament, they were very interested in finding the difference between the Old Testament and the New Testament. And there was absolutely no objection, no constraint on them. They felt no constraint that the religious subjects meant Christian religious subjects. Of course, Christianity is based on both the Old and the New Testament.
So do I understand correctly what you are saying is that the Jewish students would participate in the Christian?
Very much so.
Do you know, did they then outside of the formal school curriculum, did some of your Jewish classmates get Jewish religious education outside? Do you know?
This is a blessing of a question. This is a very good question. Now, had the Jews tended to set up their own clubs, I don't say organizations, even clubs, they would have become identifiable as a different entity by people of ill will. And one of the happy coincidences in Bulgarian Jewish affairs was that the Jews did not care to set up clubs, organizations of their own. They were satisfied with enlisting in the various clubs that exist in every college, together with the Christians. Although some of these clubs were notably linked to Christian morals, to Christian thinking, they did not feel they had to stay aside from that. That was something which was very typical, and that was something which, with which the Jews should be credited for the good relations between Bulgarians and Jews. That is something with which the Jewish community in Bulgaria should be credited for enabling us Bulgarians to treat them as our own people. They had no desire to, as I said, set up clubs of their own, which would have been perfectly legitimate. They were quite willing to mingle entirely with Bulgarian clubs and to stay there. And when some of us feel happy or feel proud of our treatment of the Jews, I think we must add to that, that this was a two-way affair, that it takes two to make a couple, it takes two to pick up a quarrel, and the Jews undoubtedly played their part in this fine, noble relations that were subsequently created between Bulgarians and Jews. They were part of our society.
At what age did the school start taking students? By which grade did the school
between start? It was a 6-year, my college, I mean, it was a 6-year course, the age of 13 to 18 or 19.
So, did you have, were there only boys in your school or both boys and girls?
Boys and girls lived on one campus, but divided by a wall which was stronger than the Berlin Wall. So that was not real co-education. These were the times.
Right.
So much, apparently, that's how much we could have been, we were trusted.
But as you are saying, you started at the age of 12, 13. At 13, a Jewish boy has his bar mitzvah. Did your classmates get bar mitzvahed, as you know?
What is bar mitzvah? That's the...
When a Jewish boy becomes grown-up member of the community.
They didn't celebrate that very officially. It was just a minor affair which they went through, and that was it.
You mentioned campus, so that means it was a boarding school?
Yes, a boarding school.
What did the Jewish classmates do on Saturday? Was there school on Saturday?
They went to school on Saturdays. It was no concession on their part. They always said we are Bulgarians Jews. Bulgarians hyphen Jews. And not Bulgarian Jews. Not Jews, but Bulgarians Jews. At the end, that's how it ended.
Mm-hmm. What about high holidays? If there was, let's say, Pesach or Shoshana?
We celebrated them with them. We celebrated these. We Christians took part in some of their ceremonies or rites.
Can you describe where did you go to celebrate?
Well, those of us who had good friends among the Jews were invited on Friday evening to celebrate Passover with them, with the whole families of four generations. So we stood there and we enjoyed that immensely as a privilege. And then we were very much intrigued by the unleavened bread they ate. So the Jews in my native town, they had to prepare enormous quantities of unleavened bread because we ate that bread too. And we insisted on that. We haven't brought enough for the whole class. So imagine how much bread these Jewish families had to bake. And it was not those of the of today's rather elaborate type of something like a biscuit. No, it was simply unleavened bread. So we mixed together. We took part in their rites as well, as outsiders, to be sure.
Did you ever get a chance to go to temple with them or to synagogue?
No, we didn't go that far, because we were not churchgoers as Protestants or Catholics would be.
Churchgoers, how was it in school, for example?
In school, they sang praises to Jesus, the Jews, just as we did.
Did you have religious services?
Yes,
at
the American college, we had, I wouldn't say more than our share, but we had a wonderful share of religious services, which meant every day a morning service between the second and third study period of 20 minutes, with anthems being sung at the beginning and at the end. Every Sunday, a very official thing, with choir singing, orchestra performances, religious of course, with your Sunday best, and the girls to the one side of the hall, the boys to the other. So one chance to see the other sex, which we didn't see for months on end sometimes. But that was not the aim of it. So, what was interesting about these church services was that they were not always directly linked to religion, but they were linked to other topics of all human interest. If, for instance, they found queer Jay, an Indian who decided to walk all the way from London to Delhi and pass through Sofia with a dog and a whip, you know. And if the our American teachers thought that this would make an interesting speaker, So they invited him to one of those weekday chapels, and that was so interesting and so intriguing to both boys and girls.
We have to stop this tape. Yeah. I guess I'll ask you. April 27, 1998, I'm talking with Mr. Chakalov. This is tape number 2. While we were changing tapes, you mentioned something about the names of your Jewish classmates. Would you send me that again?
I think in human relations, one good turn gives rise to a gut, to a good turn from the other side. So one of the good turns on the part of the Jewish community was a gradual tendency of modifying, not necessarily changing or abandoning their names, of modifying their names to suit Bulgarian first names and Bulgarian family names. The Bulgarian family name grammatically constitutes the genitive of a Christian name, a first name. That means Ivan of Ivan. Ivan Ivanov. Of is the genitive. So, in a society of such type of names, the Jews felt a little bit awkward that you never knew whether, say, Isaac Levy, just which was which. So, to make it clearer, they began calling themselves Isaac Leviev, or Bohor, instead of Monahem, they would call them Bohor Monahemov. Even such long names, they changed that in the Bulgarian fashion. And this development naturally brought them closer to integration, without losing identity, to integration, to friendly relations with Bulgarians, with the Bulgarian society.
To your knowledge, back in history, is that something that had happened in the past already, or did that start to happen while you were growing up?
That was almost immediately after that big flow of Jews from Spain to Bulgaria, from persecutions in Spain. Most of the Bulgarian Jews spoke as their second language, maybe as their native language. They spoke Spanish, kind of Spanish dialect. So they were Spanish Jews who had en masse moved to Bulgaria after persecutions in Spain, probably at the beginning of the 19th century. And immediately those good relations between Bulgarians and Jews started with the influx of that Jewish community. And immediately they began changing their names, and that went on as a process. To the extent that today, and 50 years ago, the name Avramov, which means Abrahamov, is borne by many Bulgarians no longer remember they were Jews originally. Avramov today is a Bulgarian name just as much as it is a Jewish name. Imagine the intermingling of society, Jewish and Bulgarian society.
Among your friends in school, those that you socialized with, also outside the school setting, do you remember, were there any families where Ladino was still spoken?
Yes, early in my childhood. Later on, no.
So maybe let's go back to your early childhood that we left so abruptly half an hour ago. Where did you grow up? Was that the house that you lived in, looking across the Gulf? Was that an apartment? Was it a house?
You see, we never owned a house. My father was a doctor, although he subsequently specialized in France and was a very good doctor. somehow...
What did he specialize in? I'm sorry.
Children medicine, I don't exactly...
Pediatrics.
Yeah. Pediatrics. Somehow or other he became disgusted with helping people recover their health, saving their lives and getting money out of it. Again, some kind of uncontrolled trend in his attitudes to our life. So he was always looking for a government job as a doctor so that he would be paid by someone else, not necessarily by the one who is in distress. And though he was an Orthodox, he stemmed from a Protestant family, and that has something to do with it as well. You see, when Romanians occupied my native place in 1919, it so happens that in such localities of people who don't have high education, they look upon an educated man like a doctor, particularly a doctor who serves society so directly, not necessarily as a person who knows more about physics or anything else, but as an intellectual leader. And he cannot escape from that attitude of the people. He cannot escape from that position in which the people put him. So when the Romanians came, they simply pushed him to the front as their intellectual leader. So the Romanians arrested him, and they had already kept him as prisoner of war for 2 years during the war. And the population rose. And at the moment where they were taking him from the police station into the police van to lead him away, again, the population gathered there, and in the span of that narrow sidewalk of the street, they arrested him from the hands of Romanian police. Unfortunately, in the process, a Romanian policeman was stabbed.
So what year was that?
That was 1919.
The year you were born?
Yes. So there was no other choice for him but to flee across, and for the family to flee across. And in the immediate post-war years, we had to live in a very remote village, 3 years, for fear of persecution by the Allied occupying, I mean persecution, not, it was looking for a criminal by the Allied occupying powers.
What was and your father accused of?
He was not accused, but they could have easily blamed, he was called the instigator. You see, it was not too difficult to prove such a role in a Romanian court and scare the population by punishing their leader, their own their chosen leader, their leader selected by themselves. That would have been expedient for the Romanian authorities.
What was the name of the village you went to?
The
for three
name
years?
Of the village is difficult to pronounce. It was Kozluja. K-A-Z-L U-D-J-A, Kozluja. That was near Varna, and later on when things settled down and there were no occupation troops in Bulgaria, we moved to the town of Varna.
In
Kozluja, yes.
Kozluja. Was your father able to work as a physician?
Yes, he worked as a physician.
Do you have any recollection of the time when you were in that village?
They are more or less not direct recollections of mine, but what I know from my brother, sister, from my mother. It was a very small village which could not support a physician. And he could not get a government job at that time. So it was a life of poverty and destitution with three children.
Your brother's name is?
My brother's name, he's 4 years my senior, is Nikola. That's Nicholas without the S. Nicola.
And your sister's name?
My sister's name is Maria, which means Mary.
When was your sister born?
My sister was born in 1912, and my brother in 1915. My sister is of hallowed memory. My brother is alive, 83 now.
Tell me more about the political involvement of your fathers in this time. What do you know about that?
If we mean by political involvement, political parties, I could say that he never belonged to a particular party, but he was prone to support the one which at the particular time was the most liberal. So, and that was it. He did not take any part in party political activities.
Was he part of any organizations or movements at the time?
My father was a Mason, and that accounted for much of his moral image. He was a very devout Mason, very respected Mason, having been Mason, Freemason, I mean, in the United States as a student. And that fitted his moral strivings, his moral requirements to the T.
Did that, though, fit with the rest of his family, or was that something unusual to happen?
No, that was perfectly normal. Perfectly normal.
So after these 3 years of
self-imposed exile,
yeah.
Yes.
What happened then?
Then he moved to the town of Varna on the Black Sea, one of the two big Bulgarian ports, big Bulgarian ports. And he, by that time, he had already become disgusted with taking money out of the wretched people to help them and to save them. So he got a government job as a physician of the Bulgarian railways. And he bought a bicycle. So he was known as the doctor on the bicycle, because when you called the doctor, the procedure was to pay for the couch or chariot or whatever it was that took him to the patient somewhere away. So in order to save money for his patients, he got a bicycle. He was known as the doctor on the bicycle. He would go there, and since he had a salary, and then he worked also, he had two jobs. He worked for the railways in the morning, and he was the factory doctor in the afternoon. He went to a factory and was and inspected the people there. So we had sufficient income, though we never possessed a home. We never had any particularly fine furniture. We had three children in the family, and having been chased out of your home from Dobruja. That was our position. That was the family in which we grew.
Who took care of you when you were very small?
My mother was a housewife, only a housewife. And the experience on the street with the chums.
Tell me more about your mother. How did she look like?
My mother was only 23 years younger than my father. But upon looking at them, you couldn't see the difference, both outwardly and mentally. They liked one another very much, and she very often used to call him Dad. See, taking over from the kids. In a way, it could have been a disastrous family with that difference. Nobody ever felt it in any way. I mean, I don't know why. It's one of those things that happened.
Did your mother have any help at home?
No. My father couldn't afford that.
So she did everything from washing, cleaning, cooking?
We helped. My job was to wash the floor every day.
What did and your brother do?
Oh, my brother was the expert in shopping. My sister helped in the cooking. Helped, although it was only help and not necessarily taking over from my mother.
Where were your grandparents? Did you know your grandparents? Were they still alive?
The grandparents on my father's side were no longer living when he married, because he married at the age of 45. The grandparents on my mother's side remained in the Romanian-occupied area, so we practically had no grandparents.
Were there other relatives that you could be in touch with?
Again, not many, because my father had moved away from Sofia and the area of Sofia where his other three brothers remained. He moved to the opposite part of Bulgaria, to the Black Sea, and we didn't have relatives from my parents' side, nor did we have many relatives from my mother's side who had remained across the frontier.
How old were you when you first came to Sofia, or first visited Sofia?
About 8. To see my cousins from the three other brothers of my father. The typical thing about my father's family was that these four brothers that had remained at that time out of six brothers, two died at the age of about 30. All of them, which was not so easy for our country at the time, all of them were with university education. All of them had supported one another at the university level. My father was 20 years older than the youngest brother. And The youngest brother was a very famous Bulgarian mathematician, member of the Bulgarian Academy of Sciences. My father was a doctor. The other brother was an engineer. Yet another brother was a colonel. And in that society, at the beginning of the century, this was more or less unique.
How come, do you know, how come that your family had this intellectual blooming and blossoming happening?
I would venture an opinion which might be refuted by other members of the clan, but I think this stems from my grandfather on my father's part, who went through a very difficult period of giving up Greek Orthodox denomination for the Protestant denomination. That was something which my father remembers that very well, which happened after my father was christened as an Orthodox Christian. My grandfather didn't like the doings of the Orthodox Christian priests, but to reject your religion at that time needed a very strong moral impact to explain to society why the leader of the my grandfather was a tailor. The leader of the Tailors Guild would give up Christianity. I mean, not Christianity, but that's what they thought. And go to another church. That was a horrifying experience for my grandfather. So, this adherence to moral standards, this search for the better within the moral standards, was what accounted, to my mind, for the quest for knowledge and for upbringing, for education by the sons. Mm-hmm. I venture an opinion, as I said, which may not be shared, but it is a fair guess as to what had really happened.
At home, in your house, being a young boy, what do you remember, let's say, at the dinner table? What kind of topics did come up?
The dinner table in my home, in the presence of my father, who had seen so much of the world, was part of my education, a very important part of my education. Something which I was privileged to have, unlike other schoolmates of mine. There was always a very brief prayer before we started eating. Always only at lunch, not at supper. And it was usually the first lines of some of the Psalms, and that was all. Communion with my father was something, was a source of knowledge, to the extent that sometimes he would tell us, "Now, Sonny, even the most intelligent man can answer a smaller number of questions than the most uneducated can ask." So we relied on him for information on anything. And we had the source. We had the Encyclopedia Britannica with us.
Which topics were you most interested when you were growing up? was that, I mean, just to give you...
Yes.
Was it philosophy? Was it religion? Was it politics? Was it literature? Was it social surrounding matters?
The most important, the most frequent topic of conversation was linked to something which few people can understand. It is the topics that dominate an immigrant family, which went to the extreme of irredentism, of hate for the Romanians. I must admit it, I don't have it now. But the environment in which we grew, the suffering, the fact that my father nearly lost his life during the first 2 years of imprisonment without any legal accusation as to something wrong that he had done, simply because he was an instigator. He wasn't an instigator. He was picked up by the population, which believed that education means something God knows what, and he was their leader. They wanted him. And hence he became the instigator, and the Romanians persecuted him. So my childhood was dominated very much by the yearning, when I grow up, to do nothing else but join the army. And as simple as that, it may seem horrible now, it does seem horrible to me, but irredentism is something which affects human souls, and even the human souls of normal humans. You are simply driven into it. You are the patient of a disease. You are not the criminal that has acquired something abnormal in himself.
Was the level of pain that you were describing, was that, do you think, the same throughout your childhood, or were there changes?
Unfortunately, it went also when I went to that liberal-minded American college. I couldn't accept the idea of being all-forgiving, unfortunately. That's how I started.
We'll stop the tape. April 27, 1998. I'm talking with Mr. Chakalov, and this is tape number 3. How old were you when you came to your American college?
I was 13, and I had the privilege of being given a generous scholarship because, see, my father, having married at the age of 45, and I being the third child, and he being the type of earning father, very modest in his earnings and his ways of earning for the family, I couldn't pay the tuition. But since we were already three people of our family who had gone through the American college. My sister went and took the full course of the American college just before I went there. So it was conceivable that we would be treated somewhat differently and benevolently.
Do I understand correctly, when you arrived, your sister had already graduated?
Yes, precisely.
Tell me, where exactly was the school located? How far away was that from home?
As I told you, this was the so-called Samokov American School. It was in the town of Samokov, which is 40 miles to the south of Sofia. That was the school from which my father had graduated, and that was the school which my sister joined. And in the time between, 26 and 31, my sister and the college moved from Samokov to the vicinity of Sofia, a newly built campus, a wonderful place. So I went to that college, which was already named the Sofia American College and not the Samokov American College. But it was the very same institution.
How often did you get to go home?
We got home three times in the year, for a Christmas vacation, for an Easter vacation, each of about 10 to 12 days, and for a pretty long summer vacation of sometimes over 2 months. This was in compliance with Bulgarian practice, the practice of the Bulgarian high schools.
The school curriculum, was it Bulgarian, was it American, was it a mixture of both? What was it?
It was a mixture of both, and that accounted for the fact that the course of the American college was 6 years, which was a high school course, so to speak, compared to the 5 years of the Bulgarian high schools. It was because we had many subjects which were subjects of an American college. And we could take more subjects and have more class hours because it was a boarding school.
Which subjects were your favorite?
I was the greediest student. And as boys, we had our way of expressing it, said, let us try to root to route that American college by taking all the subjects that can be offered, and to ruin the American college by enlisting for all subjects that could be offered. This was a kind of boyish attitude. Well, funnily enough, one of the school subjects that I remember best now was a school of comparative religions, a study of comparative religions based on a wonderful study by Professor Hume. We had his book. Each one of us had and probably still has it, in which he examined the 11 written religions, Shintoism, Jainism even, those that had holy scriptures. And that wonderful mind of a scholar, Professor Hume, was able to classify or to subdivide into subjects all religions into 51 subjects. For instance, family relations, the golden rule, the duty to society, such topics. And in his book, he quoted the relevant texts from Jainism, Judaism, Muslim, Shintoism, Buddhism on that subject, say the golden rule. So this was both religion, this was both one way of seeing how peoples, or even people, put it more simply, who historically and geographically couldn't have had any links, came to the same conclusions about the Supreme Being. So that was real religion. And the golden rule, well, it's the same all over. Do not to others. And this was one of the most interesting subjects. The attitude we had is, we are paying, or we are working our way through college. Our parents are paying. Let's get from college as much as we can. That was a boyish attitude, which was very positive.
What did you like to do when you were not studying?
My fair share of sports. Yes. 2 hours a day. Fields were open to us. Baseball, tennis, football, volleyball, basketball. In the winter, skiing. We had another game of dodgeball. That was indoor game. Yes.
And on Sundays, what happened on Sundays?
Sundays were a serious affair at college. Sundays, the whole morning was church service, wonderful church service, in your Sunday attire. And in the afternoon, the boys who had their parents in Sofia would see them, and we would stand around because there was always a chocolate bar more than for the kids. That was kind of a holiday. That was in the afternoon. And whoever wanted to go into the gym or put on the gym clothes could play.
Did you get invited to Sofia sometimes?
That was quite strict at the American college. The boys who had their parents in Sofia had only 1 weekend per semester. And mind you, there were girls' weekends and boys' weekends. So the fence between the two colleges spread throughout.
Was there any teacher that you recall where you think that person really influenced your thinking?
Elizabeth, let me make a very sweeping remark. All our teachers were excellent. All our teachers were excellent. It's very difficult to draw a comparison within the superlative degree. They were the best we could think of. Very much devoted, and unlike the normal Bulgarian teachers, they lived on the campus, of course. We had the privilege of communicating with them out of the class. And their example, as young Christians, well, that was something priceless.
Did you find a difference in what they taught you compared to that what you had learned from your parents?
No, not in the very least. There was no conflict between family upbringing and college education. I'm not speaking in the first person singular. I mean the students all found no collision between the two.
Well, what I'm maybe trying to get to is that you shared before that how much your father was still under the shock or pain, what had happened to him. How would that compare to what you heard from your teachers?
Yes, that's a very interesting question, because in this respect, unfortunately for me, and it's a confessed sin, I was at variance with what they taught me. The gift of forgiveness, and so on and so forth. You see, young boys tend to venerate heroes, and I didn't want to shirk from the fate of being a hero, liberating his homeland. This is paying tribute to some kind of usefulness, ill-conceived, true enough, but something which befalls human beings.
So, if we think of which were the years that you were at the college, that was from which
yes,
year
on? I just want to add something else. Our American teachers and the entire American college was a pacifist place in the best and purest sense of the word, a Christian pacifist place. And I feel very much indebted to the patience with which, and that is what has really that. What really, in the final account, won me over, to the patience with which those American modern missionaries, if you can understand, argued with me, heard my arguments, and said they simply do not fully understand me, instead of censuring me for being wrong. That was wonderful. And this is what I call education. This is what I call educators. This is what I call enlighteners. I can never stop praising them. And even 4 days ago, I found here my dean when I was freshman. I had never lost contact with him. He is my spiritual leader, has remained my spiritual leader. A bit moved all my life.
Well,
he is Professor Sanders, aged 89, who was my guest here 4 days ago. He is still on the board of the American College. He came here for a session, and it was a wonderful experience meeting somebody whom I still want to emulate because of his brilliant mind, still wonderful, brilliant, intelligent man. And only through emulating him, I must have profited very, very much. So, such people who were so tolerant to us, taught us tolerance in the right way.
What were you taught about the politics of the time at school? Because the year you came to the American college was the year, which year?
That was 33.
And you left in?
In 38. You see, these were the crucial years of the rise of Nazism.
Exactly. So what did you...
They didn't mince their words in condemning Nazism, the American teachers. It was right out, outright condemnation of dictatorship, of Nazism. They were very much outspoken.
While in the college, during those years, were you exposed to outside news, like newspapers, radio, any other ways of
yes, we were allowed to receive any newspapers we liked. We could listen to the broadcasts of the radio. But the our American teachers managed to install in our way of thinking a screen which enabled us to cast out all propaganda. They taught us how to think properly, and that was the surest way of keeping us from Nazi propaganda or for any other deviation of this kind.
Well, you told me before that a good percentage of your classmates were Jewish.
Yes.
Do you recall any discussions with your Jewish classmates about the political developments both within Bulgaria and outside Bulgaria at the time?
Not on the basis of Bulgarian Jewish relations, because there was no difference between the attitudes of Jews and Bulgarians towards these events.
No, but did for example, your Jewish classmates, do you recall hearing from them any thoughts or feelings about what was happening around them? Did they feel threatened?
In foreign countries, in Germany and so, or in Bulgaria?
Both.
You see, since they felt part of Bulgarian society, they were just, and to the same extent, and in the same directions critical as we were. They were, well, not more critical than we actually were towards what was happening in Germany. They were apprehensive, more than we were, because that wouldn't have affected us personally and directly. And we were always ready to agree with them to the fullest what should be done in Bulgaria with them on our part and with us all if that plague came to Bulgaria.
So what were your thoughts? What did you think of doing? What did you think should have been done in
you see,
the best
case? It was expressed in an indirect manner, but in a very stiff manner. Namely, we Bulgarians, that generation that we were, we would under no conditions allow a blemish on our nation, which would be a historical blemish. We will not allow anybody to be persecuted on grounds of birth, having been born Bulgarian or Jew. You see, it was both love for the Jews and fear of what our generation might allowed to be done with Bulgarian name, with the name of Bulgaria, that Bulgaria sent away its Jews to be slaughtered. No, this cannot happen. Such a blemish, such a shame on our generation. No, that will not happen, whatever the consequences should be. And in our relations with the Germans subsequently, as when I became liaison officer to Germans and to other missions, in our relations, this was our motive. It's our historical responsibility. Bulgaria has a history of 13 centuries. We shall not be the ones now to put such a stigma, such a horrible mark on Bulgarian history. We cannot do that. Nobody can force us to do that.
During the years in school, these 5 or 6 years, was there any change in the composition of the classmates, meaning were there people who left because of whichever political circumstances? Were there classmates who would come in new from other countries?
No change whatsoever. No change. The attitudes, the overall picture of the classes remained absolutely the same.
Did you hear about Jews coming to Bulgaria from Austria, from Hungary, from Germany at the time?
Yes. There were some who came, but not many. Unfortunately, few could foresee that Bulgaria would be a haven, that Bulgaria couldn't do anything but be a haven, that everything else was impossible to work in society, in Bulgarian society.
Did you come across any Jewish refugees from those countries, if you remember?
Not personally, but I knew of such people through friends. There were not many. They were dozens and not more. But unfortunately, they remained in their second homes or in their countries.
So am I correct in understanding that while you were at the American college, the knowledge that you got or the information that you got about political developments was mostly through your teachers, through newspapers and radio,
yes,
but not necessarily by witnessing it yourself?
No. You see, by the year 38, at least that was our impression, it may have been wrong, the real persecution of the Jews had not started. It started with the years of the war.
what did your Jewish classmates talk about in this context?
Well, they didn't feel threatened because nobody thought that we would be occupied by the Germans. No one could foresee such a thing. Then, and this is something very important which I wish to point out, the Nazi philosophy was horribly simple towards nations and peoples. They subdivided Europe into Germans, Germanic people, and the rest was Jews and Slavs. And Slavs. See, Germanic people were the Swedes, the Danes, even Spaniards, even Italians, because they were non-Slavic. So the Germans the Nazis, and I felt that we were not taught that in so many words. You had to derive that conclusion through the German Nazi ideologists, that future Europe would mean Germany. Very often they spoke of Europe instead of saying Germany. Future Europe would be Germany. British, French, all the rest that were not Slavs would be Germanic peoples. This is another category. That is why they behaved, that may have been news to some people, they behaved more carefully towards Danes, Belgians, Dutch, because these were not Slavs. These would be the people, the second category, on which the future European Germany would be based. But when it came to the Slavs, when they conquered the Ukraine was always ready to separate from the Soviet Union, but they said, no, we will not tolerate and we will not help you in your nationalistic struggles against the Russians. The Ukraine was called Reichskommissariat für die Ukraine. Reichskommissariat. It was the German commissariat. That was, and also Belarusian Republic. It was called Reichskommissariat Ostland. So that was the avowed policy of the Germans toward the other nations of Europe. And we Bulgarians, as Slav, although temporarily dubbed allies by the Germans, we were in that category. Do we have to stop? I think
we have to stop.
I would like to say something. May I just intervene for a second? Sorry. Very sorry indeed.
April 27, 1998. I'm talking with Mr. Chakalov. This is tape number 4. Were there any Nazi thoughts coming up among your schoolmates?
No. Simply no. No influence by Nazism on Bulgarian thinking. When I say no, that means with the exception of hundreds within a population of 7 million. And it was very bad taste to praise Nazism in Bulgaria all along.
You finished the American Academy education when?
I graduated from my college in 1938.
And what were your plans for the next step? What did you plan to do?
Unfortunately, I was swayed into going to the military academy, to the officers training school for a course of 4 years.
Why do you say unfortunately?
Well, unfortunately, because this was still done on that irredentist trend of becoming an officer for the sake of becoming an officer that would liberate his homeland. And this was not a very thorough, discussed decision on my part. And it brought me into a difficult life where my homeland, my hometown was liberated, ceded back by the Romanians in 1940. Of course, more or less under pressure. So I didn't have to fight them. And all my training was in vain. That's why I say, unfortunately, that was of no use.
Were you supported by your parents in your decision?
They were neutral.
What choices of post-high school education had your siblings made?
See, within the army, within the military academy, I obtained the training of an engineer, electrical engineer, in the field of communications. And then, with no public use for me as army officer, I retired. Or rather, the communists sacked us all because of our failure to accept the new regime. And then after that...
Which year was that?
That was in 46.
So, but when you started fresh in the academy, that was a long way.
That was, yes. I joined the academy in 1938 and graduated from it in 41. I took the four-year course somewhat in an accelerated manner during the war without vacation, so we had 3 semesters a year. That was wartime requirements to hurry up with the training of people.
Can you describe a little bit your training and your life at the military academy?
Yes, we were selected out of 5,000 candidates in 2 successive examinations. The first one rejected 4,000 of them, and then the remaining 1,000 candidates competed for 122 places. So this was a somewhat unnatural milieu. People of, well, more than normal intelligence. And we had 11 study periods a day and 2 or 3 hours of preparing lessons. It was a hectic program, very difficult. And we were all perfectly motivated, entirely idealistic. There were cases which no one would understand today, when an officer who was respected made a very strongly worded remark on one of the cadets, and he attempted suicide on the spot. It's not understandable now. But out of respect for this officer, he said, "Very, very sorry, sir, I deserve it." He went that far. See, life didn't mean anything.
You witnessed incidences of that
kind? Yes, friend of mine. Subsequently, he was killed by the communists, of course. He was slaughtered by the communists. Because he was an idealist. And I think that saved me was the fact that I was linked to foreign missions. So I had to be wary of doing something very much illegal with me. These were conditions. I mean, war is a horrible thing.
While in the academy, among these 120 future officers, what kind of political thinking were you exposed to? What different groups did you find?
The thing that was accepted by us, not necessarily forced upon us, was that we were in no way interested in political parties. No way interested in what party proclaims what. This is not our business. We are above that. We are not excluded from it.
Was that something you were taught?
No, that was the accepted thing, the accepted moral standard by us all.
But the origin of these 120 young men must have been quite diverse.
Oh yes, but in this self-imposed requirement, we were all of one mind. We cared nothing about political structure, about platforms of political parties. We detested such things as political platforms. We served our country in the absolute manner.
What about political, if you want, platforms or political beliefs that were predominant outside Bulgaria in the neighboring countries? What were the thoughts that, or the discussions that you had with your other friends in the academy?
I'm afraid the truth is that there was an outright negation on our part to care about such things. That may not have been correct. But we thought this has nothing to do with our life as officers.
Did you ever discuss what was happening in Russia or what was happening in Germany and what kind of political thinking made things or pushed things forward?
I'm afraid I was always thinking about Bulgarian internal politics, but when it came to foreign relations, we were definitely dead set against Nazism and communism. And also Italian fascism. We did not approve of that. We didn't want it to be installed in our country. And that was why we could never put up with German attempts when German armies settled in Bulgaria. We could never put up with German attempts to sell Nazi thinking to us.
Explain how did you then at the time see Bulgaria's political position in that what we could maybe call and being allies with Germany for some time? How can you explain that?
Yes, this is, I wouldn't blame any foreigner to be unable to understand it, and I'll try to explain it in the simplest manner. In the course of the war, the Allies, let's say Britain, landed an expeditionary corps in Greece. So that was a menace, had that corps been increased in numbers. That was a menace to Germany. And that is what made the Germans go through Yugoslavia, through Romania, and through Bulgaria, ask to be permitted to go through Bulgaria, in order to fight the British Expeditionary Corps in Greece. Bulgaria conceded to join in a special manner without taking part in military operations, simply to allow the German troops to go through Bulgaria. An outright concession. But each country has to make some concessions. We would have been overrun by the Germans anyway. And the government has to take care of its citizens. So under very special terms, we allowed the German armies to go through Bulgaria. These special terms included such incredible things as our maintaining diplomatic relations with the Soviet Union. All the time that the Germans were fighting the Soviet Union, and we were Germany's sort of allies. It went to the extreme that at that time people didn't have ambassadors, they had minister plenipotentiaries. The only two ambassadors in Bulgaria who were of a higher rank were the German and the Soviet. This is an indication of the degree of freedom which Bulgaria reserved in its foreign relations, of the degree of freedom which enabled us also to say, well, we won't let the Bulgarian Jews go out of this country. Another very important thing is contained in the declaration of war made by Hitler, who never read his speeches, he spoke them. And this is something which is forgotten by many historians, including Bulgarian historians. When he declared war on the Soviet Union in June, on June 22, 1941, he listed Germany's allies, saying that the Hungarians were bold to take arms, the Romanians also, and we were allies as well, a different type of allies, nonetheless, we were allies as well. You know what he said? And Bulgaria did nothing to oppose or thwart our war efforts. Is that how you describe an ally who did nothing to oppose you? So we belong to the category of Slav people that would have been immediately subjected by Germany and treated as, well, a very, very different category of human beings, although we were temporary Slavs, and we knew that. That is why we did not yield to them of our own accord. We opposed them to the extent that that was possible. This was the peculiar situation of Bulgaria.
From your knowledge and point of view, who was instrumental in the decision of letting the German army pass through Bulgaria?
It was a very heavy, very difficult decision to take. And the government took the one that saved the lives of the Bulgarian boys. Egotistically, maybe. But each government has to cater for its own people.
But what I'm trying to ask is, was this decision made by the government, by the parliament, by the king, by who?
By all in power. By all in power. Because we saw what happened in neighboring Yugoslavia when it tried to resist the Germans. That cost 1 million lives. And that example impressed our government and said, okay, under special conditions, we will allow the German army to go and fight its adversaries now landing in Greece.
How did you feel about the territories of Macedonia and Thrace coming to the Bulgarian territory?
Yes, if the U is in the singular, I would say I was very much opposed to that, because the population in Thrace was Greek. The population in Macedonia was not necessarily Bulgarian, it was Macedonian. The fact that Macedonians felt very close at that time, not today, to Bulgarians, the fact that we had several hundred thousand Bulgarians of Macedonian origin living peacefully in Bulgaria, that we were very closely linked, did not entitle us to claim Macedonia as part of Bulgarian territory. It was a concession on the part of our government to move our troops there and to enable German troops to be removed from Thrace and Macedonia and to fight their war. And in a way, we tried to protect that population from German outrages, from German oppression. But this was a concession. I mean, unfortunately, concessions were necessary.
You spoke about 5,000, you said, that tried to get into the in your class at the military
yes.
academy.
Yes.
What happened with those who were rejected? Would they then join the regular army, you think? Or
yes. They went into the regular army, had their regular military service, which was obligatory. Conscription.
In those 3 years, you graduated in 1941, you said, right?
Yes.
Did you live within the academic quarters?
Yes. That was simply barracks that we lived in. And I was immediately transferred to the Ministry of Defense, Ministry of War, on account of, I didn't know that, on account of the information contained in my personal card with a few foreign languages, so say, although I was an engineer, in times of war, you're being used the way your boss wants you to use it. And they transferred me as liaison officer. First liaison to many foreign military attaches. Later on, when it was only the Germans who remained. And after that, after we expelled the Germans, liaison officer to American and British missions.
Well, let's start at the beginning. You graduated exactly when, do you recall?
On the 16th of June, 41.
And then you went exactly where? Where was your desk or your working place?
My desk was in the building of the Ministry of War. And I was part of a section, of a liaison section, which consisted of two or three people. And my job was to maintain contact with foreign missions and military missions.
Who did you report to? Who were those two people? Do you recall their names?
Colonel Kostov, K-O-S-T-O-V. He was a graduate of both the Bulgarian Military Academy and of the French Military Academy before the war. He was a general staff officer, and he was a classmate of General de Gaulle. So he was far from being a Nazi or anything of that kind. And that liaison section, this was the person in charge of military intelligence. So both Bulgarian military intelligence and the liaison section, which was part of it organizationally, were working against, all the time and only against, German influence, against German encroachments. That was our liaison work.
Describe, please. I want to hear that.
You see, the German army would lay a claim, of course, against payment, to be procured with so much cheese and so much flour, butter. They see that the Bulgarian population still has cheese and butter and so on. We were the ones to say no. Get it from Germany. Then they would request quarters. They would pay for that. And good pay it was. We would say no, sorry. They would require all sorts of things, but particularly we tried to stop them from interfering in Bulgarian public life, of holding rallies that might affect the feelings of the population. And the Germans had a typical way of smuggling through provisions in order to say, well, we are entitled to that according to the agreement between our governments allowing German armies to pass through Bulgaria. These were constant conflicts. That was our liaisoning with the Germans.
You mentioned that at the beginning you were working as a liaison to different military attaches.
Yes.
Which ones were those that you personally worked with?
I personally worked with practically no other military attache, but I was immediately engulfed as being the youngest officers. Immediately engulfed with relations with the Germans, much to my dislike. So that took practically, I was more or less specializing in dealings with the Germans, although I didn't speak German very fluently. So I really had no other contacts. Well, contacts at the banquet table, yes, but not real working contacts.
At that time, did you keep any contact or friendly relationships with any of your classmates from the American Academy?
Yes, but not too much, because they served in the field, they served in the in Macedonia or in Thrace, and I was serving in an office.
What happened with your Jewish classmates?
Yes, this is something I'm eager to tell you. We, not only I, people in my position, deliberately kept ever stronger contacts with the Jews. Now, there was a time shortly before we managed to get rid of the Germans, when one concession that was made by the Bulgarian authorities was to stick the yellow star on the clothes of the Jews. What happened was that if there were 50,000 Jews, the stamps that were sold numbered 500,000, because Bulgarians bought them and put them. And they walked about. What happened is for me to get two Jews with the stars on, they were not allowed to parade in the main street of Sofia. Get two of them as an officer in full uniform and parade with them through that street. Just to express what every Bulgarian expressed, dislike for these measures.
When was that happened with the...
That was in 43. These were about the worst years of German presence, not occupation, in Bulgaria.
Okay. We have stopped the tape.
Yeah.
April 27, 1998. I'm talking with Mr. Chakalov, and this is tape number 5. You were telling me about walking with two Jews with the yellow star left and right. Who were those people? Did you know them?
Classmates of mine.
Remember their names?
Yes, Mois Beracha, of hallowed memory. And again, Moritz Yom Tov. He had already changed his name to Yom Tov. Yes. Shall I spell the names?
Please.
Morris is Morris. B E R E H A. And Morris again. Y O M T O V, also of hallowed memory.
What was their activity or profession at the time?
The first one was studied for a lawyer, and the second was a doctor.
Were there any Jewish students in the military academy?
No, not when I was there. It was not forbidden, but somehow or other, the custom, the attitude of society is that Bulgarian officers should be of Bulgarian origin. That was, there was no rule forbidding them. As a matter of fact, prior to that, we had Jews who were colonels, Jews who were captains, and Jewish colonels who were decorated with the highest distinction for bravery in the war. And they were trainees of the officers' training schools. But somehow or other, there was a social accord that Bulgarian officers would serve their, would do their service to the country best if they were of pure Bulgarian origin. That was the situation.
Any other minorities?
No other minorities. No other minorities, unthinkable, no.
What did you know about the situation of other minorities in Bulgaria?
I think it went even to the extent of prohibition, with the exception of the Jewish minority. With the Jewish minority, there are cases of earlier years when they served in the officers' training school and got their commission as officers. But with the Turkish minorities, no. And I wonder if there was any Turk, unfortunately, in Bulgaria who could possibly conceive his getting through these horrible entrance examinations, admission examinations. Because, again, I said unfortunately, because the Turkish population, just as the Gypsy population, it, due to the Muslim religion, had become so self-excluded from Bulgarian life that they didn't care for any education. They, religion forced them, compelled them to live in their own Turkish villages or Ottoman villages without any Christian in it and without any Turk settling in a Christian village. So with this self-imposed discrimination, they remained an inferior part, intellectually inferior part of the population. And it was inconceivable for some of them to claim the intelligence of going through these examinations.
Are you aware of any other minorities that had this tendency, be it now out of their own will or imposed on them, to live together in clusters?
Yes, we had the Armenian minority, which very much like the Jewish minority became part of Bulgarian society. And it was possible for Armenians also to become army officers. But they themselves wouldn't feel all too well. Getting in front of a Bulgarian platoon and having an Armenian name was simply the thing considered not the right thing to do.
What about Albanians or Serbs? You had Albanian and Serbish minorities, hadn't you? In Bulgaria.
We didn't have Serbs in Bulgaria, and the Albanians were much like the Gypsies. You see, we had to put up with the fact that when you set up a school in a quarter of a town that was populated half Gypsies, half Bulgarians, you get 30 pupils in the class, and in a few months you see the marked difference in the intellectual capacities of the Gypsy children and the Bulgarian children. So the constitution and laws did not allow segregation. It was difficult for the Gypsy children, for that matter for Turkish children, because they came from uneducated families. They didn't have that background with the Christian children. And later on it became an established practice, unauthorized, forbidden even, to set up unwittingly classes with Turkish children, classes with the Gypsy children, and they got the training that would be good for a truck driver, for a harvester combine operator. They were happy with it. They didn't have to study elaborate mathematics that they would never use. They would never go very much higher than high school. Never. They didn't want to. And when the communists came to power, they tried to lure the Turkish and Gypsy population to get their support by setting up special quotas for university students, for Turkish boys and Gypsy boys. When they allowed them to join an university with practically no preliminary training, with very low grades, without any competitive examination. There were quotas for Turks, quotas for Gypsies. That's what the communists thought was fair deal. But it was not fair deal on their part. They simply wanted to have some Janissaries among their ranks, I mean the communists, to have Turkish Janissaries who would be grateful to the communists that they enabled them to become, at least in name, lawyers or doctors. But this failed ingloriously. They couldn't pass the examinations. So we had to put up with this situation that they were handicapped by their way of life, by heredity, by their parents being illiterate. Unfortunate, but true.
So at the time that you were at the military academy, did you know of any Gypsies, for example, or Turks going to the university? Did that ever happen?
That happened after the communists took over in 1944.
But not before?
But not before, no. No. On a normal competitive basis, there could have been, I know of two exceptions. There could have been some 10 exceptions of Turks going through university training. They were not banned from that. If they could take the exams, well, they became doctors, they became lawyers, but on their own merit.
What about the Jewish friends?
They were eagerly accepted because they were the bright students of their own merit. See, not only that, I said before that this was, it takes two to make a couple. It takes efforts on both parties, on both sides, to develop the good relations. It was not only the benevolence of us Bulgarians that created these conditions, these wonderful relations between Bulgarians and Jews. You see, you could rely on a Jewish merchant, I'm sure I'm speaking the truth, of being more honest than the average Bulgarian, the average Jewish merchant, of being more honest than the average Bulgarian merchant. You could rely on the Jewish doctor being more attentive than the average Bulgarian doctor. And when we lost our Jewish population after the communists took over and allowed them to migrate, of 50,000 people, we felt the blow on our society. The standards of lawyers fell. The standards of merchants fell. So this is the credit of the Jewish side for the good relations between Bulgarians and Jews.
Your classmates or Jewish friends could have been also non-classmates.
Yeah.
When talking with them in these years of 41, 42, 43, did any of them have plans to leave the country?
No, unfortunately, they stayed in Bulgaria, which was a blessing for them because Bulgarian managed to keep them some. And these were classmates also of my wife. Some left to Hungary, some left to Austria, feeling that after all, these are Central European countries. But when these Central European countries were taken over by Germany, precisely these Jews never returned. So it was their unfortunate choice. And the Jews felt that there was no better place for them than our country. So they stayed.
Did you observe any kind of beginning persecution towards the Jews? And if so, what?
That's very interesting. We had to make concessions to the Germans. The gradual concessions were the following. I mean, at the time when the Germans were mad because they were losing the war, we had to make concessions. A special office was set up called Commissary's Office, or using the Russian word Commissariat, for Jewish Affairs. It was headed by a person called Velev, V-E-L-E-V. It consisted of about two or three dozen of officials, and this was the governmental institution which was responsible for the problem of the Bulgarian Jews. No particular definite functions. We resented that, particularly we officers. And there were rumors that this commissariat could be instrumental in grouping the Jews and making them ready for export to these camps. We were very sensitive about that.
How did you express your resentment?
I'm glad to say that because I have to make the following comment. What we did was no great bravery, because we rushed through an open door when we approached our authorities and asked them to help the Jews. You know what I mean? They were perfectly willing to help us. And just one particular case. We were three officers, classmates, serving in Sofia, at a wedding party. And at that wedding party,
who were the two others, sorry to interrupt?
Galab Galabov and Theodor Buchlev. Shall I spell the names?
P
please.
G-A-L-A-V. And again, the name is G-A-L-A-V-O-V. That's the dove of the dove, Galab Galabov in Bulgarian. And the other was Theodore, B-U-C-H-L-O-V, Buchlev. We were of the same class, and somebody suggested to us by way of a reproach, don't you know that lists of hostages of Jews are being prepared at that commissariat for Jewish affairs? Of course we have hostages.
Hostages from where?
Hostages from among the Jewish population who would be punished if some Jew, say, blew up a church or whatever. I'll probably have to explain. In 1943, when things became real tough, there were many instances of German soldiers, unarmed, walking the streets of Sofia at 12 in the night, who were massacred by the so-called armed detachments of the Young Communist League, among whom there were two Jewish boys. And
do you know their names?
I only know the surname of one of them, Al-Kalai. It's L-A-L-K-A-L-A-Y. And the other one was known as Peppo, but that is a nickname, P-E-P-O. Or maybe that was his first name. We tried to induce the Jews to stop this and to stop taking part in communist anti-Nazi activities.
Did you know them personally?
No. I mean, we tried to influence the Jewish community to stop these members of its community taking part in killing German soldiers, unarmed and helpless. But these killings continued.
So who would you personally talk to influence the Jewish community in that sense?
All my Jewish friends. They resented that very much too, because that did backfire on them. And that was one of my biggest troubles, being liaison officer to the Germans, because they came with the legitimate request. Will you protect our soldiers, or shall we go about sending German armed patrols in your street to protect our soldiers? It was a horrible time.
So what did you decide to do?
We put up with it. And apparently the Germans said, the procedure we have to avoid such killings is to draw a list of hostages, which would be sent to the firing squad if yet another German soldier is killed.
Help me, these hostages were those people who at the time when the list was made were already captured or captured?
No, they were prominent Jews who were threatened, who would have been threatened with firing squad if yet another German sergeant was killed. So this was a rumor. This was not true. But imagine people like us, young officers, trying to uphold the prestige of our country in a historical perspective. Mm-hmm. That we jumped up and said, this cannot be true.
Did that happen at the wedding party you mentioned?
At the wedding party. It was more or less a remark, unfriendly remark cast on us. What are your officers doing here? When the Commissariat for Jewish Affairs is setting up lists of Jewish hostages that would be sent to the firing squad if yet another thing of this kind appeared.
Who made that remark?
Well, don't remember that. Somebody simply.
Was that a Bulgarian?
A rumor, Bulgarian. He simply said, I heard the rumor. So we three officers decided to stay after the party and said, now, is there anything we can do? And we drew lots. Who was the first, second, and third? I happened to be the second. And but I was authorized to phone the Minister of the Interior that he would be murdered by an officer, Bulgarian officers in uniform, if any Jewish hostage was killed in Bulgaria.
So help me again. I'm maybe not totally following. You were those three friends.
Friends, yes.
And the plan was what?
The plan was
What would the first one do?
The first would be the first to try to kill the minister.
And if the minister failed, was who at the time?
Then the second one would kill the minister. If he failed, the third would try to kill the minister. And it was very easy to do because we had perfect access to anybody, being officers in uniform.
The Minister of Interior, who was that at the time?
Dabrowski. G A B R O V S K Y. Of course, that was a rash decision, unnecessary. But since I had an official telephone in my office in the Ministry of Defense, it was considered most effective if I would phone from my office and ask the telephone operator to ring me back in order to be certain that I'm phoning from the Ministry of Defense and that I'm really Lieutenant Chakalov, threatening the minister with murder if that were to come true. This was no great feat, I can assure you. We didn't feel we were very brave. We knew that this would work and that he would suspend anything of that kind. And if when you do it in such an open manner, it is a real threat which has to be reckoned with. See, daredevils.
Did you think of any consequences?
No.
For you?
I didn't think that would have any other consequence but stopping the minister in case he had such a thing in his mind, which he didn't have. So I phoned, and all of a sudden I found that his personal secretary was a graduate of the American College.
Who was he?
I know his name, but I cannot think of it right now. I might think of it later on. Okay. He was not a friend of mine. Anyway, I said, now please phone back number 613 War Office so that you are certain that you are talking to Lieutenant Chakalov, who is in the War Ministry. He did phone, said, now what do you want of me? Then he recognized my name as a college and he said, I'm thinking of the name anyway. And he said, well, I'm a graduate of the American College, so, and he said, I have an awkward request. Connect me to the minister. I have a threat to give to him. Personal secretary, he wanted to know what this was about. I said, well, you can tell me about that. After all, we are college boys. Yes, I told him what our intention was. I said, I won't be the first. But there are more than three ready to do that thing for the sake of Bulgaria's name in future generations. We won't have that here. That is Nazism. It isn't Bulgarian thing. Because what I can tell you, you're doing a stupid thing. There is nothing of the sort. Okay, so Dosev. D-O-S-E-V was his name. D-O-S-E-V. I said, well, I'm sorry. We didn't do anything wrong. And he laughed and said, well, then I said, well, may I check on your behalf with your authorization with the Commissariat for Jewish Affairs? So I went to Velev, whose name was already spelled, and I said, I want officially to know if you have such plans. He said, this is one of the things we have discussed, of drawing up names of people who do not exist, so that if the Germans asked us, we could say, yes, we have 100 names. So I had to believe that. No one was affected. Nothing of the sort happened. But this is not meant to make me a brave person in the eyes of people who are looking at me or listening at me. That was the easiest thing to do. Believe me. That was the easiest thing to do without any danger of anything happening, because the entire Bulgarian people were opposed to any measures against the Jews.
Can you put a date to that incident? More or less.
Yes, I can probably put it very correctly. Early September 43.
Okay. We stopped the tape. April 27, 1998, the survivor is Mr. Chakalov, and this is tape number 6. What happened, or what did you know that happened with the Jews around that period of time?
Maybe more than the Germans themselves, we were ignorant about their fate. We knew that Germans, that the Jews from Greece, from Yugoslavia, from Romania were taken to camps.
Did you know about what happened to the Jews from Macedonia and Thrace?
That is a horrible question. I wonder if I should go into it, but I feel I have to. It was a choice between reality and possible consequences, unforeseeable consequences. It was a choice between being certain that we were in a position to save the 50 million Jews of Bulgaria and the alternative of losing everything if the 40 German divisions were turned loose on Bulgaria. Then we would have lost all the Jews, including those of Thrace and Macedonia. Now, our position in Thrace and Macedonia were temporary garrisons. The Jews in Thrace spoke Greek. They knew no Bulgarian. They never thought that on account of having Bulgarian garrisons in their regions, they could enjoy protection from the Bulgarian garrisons when they were Greek. When these lands were conquered by the Germans, when the Germans were those who more or less paid for in loss of life for conquering these territories. So they did not expect, thank God, that we would be able to protect them against those Germans who conquered them. And the open question is, could we afford to do that? Could we afford to be the protectors, not of Bulgarians, but of Greeks and of Macedonians? The decision apparently was that we were unable to afford protections also for the Jews in those areas which were temporarily occupied by both Germans, because the Germans there maintained forces of occupation and not forces of a contract with the Bulgarian, of an agreement with the Bulgarian country. They were occupying power.
So now we are talking about the official decision. Yeah.
So
what about the Bulgarian man in the street or the people?
Yes, what happened was the following. At first, the convoys with Jews from Thrace passed through Bulgaria.
Did you personally see any of them?
Yes.
How were you involved?
In breaking the doors of the railroad cars and in letting the Jews get out of them.
Where was
braving the German guards in Bulgarian uniform.
Please tell me about that. When was it? Where was it? What happened?
The first two or three convoys of trains from Thrace, not from Macedonia. From Macedonia, they went directly into Serbia and so on. We knew that these were Greek Jews being transported to camps.
How did you hear about that?
From the railway authorities.
What trains?
We inquired. We wanted to know. We wanted to know each train. What kind of train? Was it a goods train or a train with German guards on it?
Help me to understand. So in your position at the ministry,
yes,
you would...
I would simply take leave and go to the railway station and see if really there are such trains or not.
Was that not... I mean, did you get this information as something that was part of your work, or
no,
did you get the information out of your personal interest?
Personal interest.
But you had access because of your position, is it that
no,
what you're saying?
No, not in my personal. Anybody could get this information from the railway authorities, asking them what is the schedule of trains through that railway station.
Did you suspect?
Oh yes, we knew.
Where did you know from?
We knew that from our garrisons in Thrace, that Jews were being hunted down and loaded on trains.
So at that time, because I don't think this is totally clear yet to me. You were positioned where within the ministry?
I was in the Ministry of War, and all those people who went and broke the doors of the train were volunteers.
At that time, were you? Was your office in Sofia?
In Sofia, yes.
In Sofia, yes, and you went exactly where to look for those trains?
At the goods stations of the railways near Sofia.
Did you do that as part of your working day, or?
No, not authorized. Not authorized.
Did you go
in uniform? In uniform, in order to be able to give an excuse to the German guards why they didn't fire on those people who broke the doors of the trains.
Who came with you?
Anybody, but mostly soldiers, ordinary soldiers, but people in uniform, because that meant that the Germans had to shoot against Bulgarian soldiers and officers, which they didn't.
Was there anybody who organized this? Because if there were many
how did it happen? Rumors, very often incorrect. There would be a train coming late at night, so we went there and inspected what that train was. The railway authorities leaked the news to us, not officially.
And can you give the number of? I mean, was there a handful of people who would go there, or would it be many people?
Hundreds, but unfortunately, we managed to free all the people from one train, and the other train pushed off with maybe a third of the inmates in the cars, and we were unable to track it.
When was
and
that?
These were only two trains that were attacked. Later on, the Germans ferried the Jews by trucks from Thrace directly into Macedonia and to the concentration camps.
These specific incidents that you are telling me about now, when did that happen?
I took part in the second and in the abortive part of the second incident. It was attacked at one railway station. I didn't take part in the first incident, which was entirely successful. I went to the second railway station where the railway authorities said they would stop the train. And when I was there and a few other people, not too many, the train was already pushing off. And where that train went to, anyway, we couldn't follow it. It escaped.
Can you give a date to that incident?
I can give a very close date. Air raids, March. After March, but just when? After the 1st of April, 43. Let me think. No, much later. After the 1st of April, 44. That's exact. 44.
Did you have any immediate contact with the people that were on the train?
No, they scattered immediately, and we didn't provide protection for them, but everybody cared for himself. The Jewish community, of course, hid them immediately. They went to the synagogues, and from there on they went into hiding. They went underground.
Was there any kind, as you know, any kind of organization that would help this?
No, there was not. No, there was not. These were accidental cases, not organized, only people, a lot of people, behind the exercise of blocking the train and opening it. And that stopped.
And I might not have understood that totally well. Were you personally involved in opening any of these trains?
I missed that train.
Okay.
Just missed it at the second stop. I wasn't at the first stop when it was successfully opened. And I missed that, I mean, that all of us who were there missed that train. You see, we were not too many at the second stop. And we could not impress the German guards. We felt that they were risking their own lives with being unable to protect the train. And they simply, when they pushed us down the steps, well, it was their duty to do so. We couldn't very well. If we were 100 or 200 people, that would have been different. But we were two dozens maybe at the second stop. We couldn't do it. We failed. The train went off.
How long was the stop there?
5 minutes. Not more than that. Our mistake was that we could not go back to the offices. It was late at night, and try to contact the railway authorities. We didn't have the proper connection with them. Everything was not well organized. It was something which came out of the blue as an occasion to take some action. We didn't know what railway authorities to contact. We couldn't locate that train at any further place. And maybe we would have been unable to send, say, a party of 100 people to block that train again.
For you going though there to the railway in full uniform, did you risk anything?
Nothing. This was no bravery at all. What I risked was that I was not in a position to strike back that German who threw me off the stairs, because it was his duty. And I fully realized as officer that that was improper on my part. A guard stationed somewhere and I'm attacking it. I have no right to do that. But had it been 100 people, then maybe he would have been able to avoid court-martial.
But towards your own superiors, that...
They would have said, well, fine thing you did. No blemish. Mm-hmm. They would have condemned me if I didn't do it, if I knew that such a thing happened. We were all absolutely united behind these things.
Were you fully aware at the time what meaning, what these transports meant for the
no.
people?
We thought they were moved for security reasons, that there would probably be military operations in those areas, and that the Germans wanted to have their rear well protected against a population which was obviously inimically disposed to a German army. So it was army routine, have a strong rear. That's what how things were explained. We didn't believe that explanation, but we didn't think that it would be such a mass extermination of human beings. Inconceivable. Then, after all, not by a nation, but within a nation that has produced the most honorable philosophers in Europe, in European history. I mean, somehow or other, you cannot get well oriented all of a sudden that such brutes could come to the top.
What in this year of 43 did you know about your Jewish friends or about the Bulgarian Jewish community? What happened to them?
The concessions that were made, and I'm not proud of that, but it's difficult to blame the people who decided that Bulgaria could make concessions to the Germans in order to avoid an outright German occupation by those 40 divisions around us. Anyway, the concessions which we disliked were the following. The Jews were not allowed to possess radio receivers at home. The argument being that, well, they get information from abroad and so on and so forth. So the radios were taken away from their homes. Then they were not allowed to have telephones. We resented that, but we didn't try to teach our government how to behave. It was there. Duty to try to steer a course of saving the Jews. That was about all. And then, as I told you, the Jews were not allowed to walk along the, what is called the Corso, that's the place where people take their evening constitutional. Not allowed.
But when did that start?
Must have started. That was about the earliest thing that started. Must have started at the beginning of 43. But it was no great bravery taking a Jew. And even the policeman, he would say, "Oh, Lieutenant, say, mind your business," and that was all. And the policeman did his duty. He was not personally against that thing, but he was told, "No, Jews cannot walk through the streets, so Lieutenant, mind your duty." "Okay, Lieutenant, it's your responsibility."
Could you socialize with your Jewish friends openly?
Absolutely, absolutely.
Did you?
We did socialize more than before, just to make them feel better at home, more at home, that we would not under any circumstances betray them.
Where did your friends live? Was there any change?
Yes, they lived in their apartments where they used to live, only without telephones later on in years, and without radios. Then there was, I'm not sure, there must have been a curfew hour for the Jews on account of these murders of German soldiers which took place. So maybe that accounted for the yellow star being worn by Jews. But there was not much evening activities in Sofia that was bombed out during the war anyway. And then the final wrong thing did by our government against the Jews was to expel from Sofia, after all these killings did not stop, to expel, but that was a blessing in disguise, to expel all the Jews from Sofia to the provinces. And that was just before the big air raids over Sofia destroyed and sent the entire population of Sofia out of the town. So it was more or less a coincidence that the Jews left Sofia days before everybody did. And they even did that in a peaceful and orderly manner. They managed to find appropriate quarters in the provinces, whereas all the Bulgarians left in panic. Mm-hmm. Sofia was very badly hit during the war by air raids from Allied forces in Italy.
Do you know about any working camps in Bulgaria?
For Jews?
Yeah.
No. Not necessarily working camps.
Labor camps?
No, but you see, it was possible, there was what was called civil mobilization. You could be drafted in the army, but it was also possible there was a legal procedure by which you could oblige a civilian to do a particular job. For instance, when the first air raids over Sofia destroyed most of the windows, people, glaziers, were, as we called, civically or civilian, that it was impossible to say, but they were mobilized as civilians. And they had to do the job of glazing the windows of the people with glass furnished by the government. Now it turned out, and this was an amazing thing for the Germans and a very strong argument for our case, it turned out that half of the glazers were Jews. Imagine what a strong argument on our part that the Jewish population was not a population of intellectuals, of lawyers, physicians, and merchants, that they were in all strata of society. So these Jews were mobilized as civilians. And it turned out that, as a matter of fact, it was the Jews who were mobilized in this. Otherwise, they could do any kind of job. There were so-called labor brigades, again, as a contingency during those army days, when you could serve a summons to somebody to turn up with a spade or with a pickaxe for 15 days to do some repair work on railways. See, the state was gradually disintegrating with the horrible war effort and with the destruction of caused by the air raids. And the Jews were apt to be the people more affected by these measures. Again, to appease the Germans.
Who then, are you saying, was part of these working brigades?
They were both Bulgarians and Jews.
Who were the Bulgarians who would work in these brigades?
Usually people without any particular profession, people of no education. Whereas with the Jews, they gradually couldn't find, particularly after the air raids started, they couldn't find occupation within their own skills. So maybe a merchant who no longer has the shop in Sofia would be drafted.
What would happen with their families, do you know?
They lived with them. These were not groups that were sent on some distant job. They would be taken by trucks, say some 20 kilometers away from Sofia, work and then return back in the evening. These were not any definite formations. They depended on the job that had to be done, on the work that had to be done, and there was nothing stationary about it.
In and around Sofia, were there any larger groups of gypsies, as you know?
Within Sofia, there were gypsy quarters, as they are called. They simply clubbed together, the gypsies.
They were called quarters?
Yes. Town quarters, that's mm-hmm. Town districts, yeah. Gypsy districts. They clubbed together because of their poverty, because they were the underprivileged people. And they lived in fairly miserable circumstances. Usually society tried to do something, but they were the last to be hired and the first to be fired.
Who would be interested in helping gypsies?
The municipal authorities were very much interested in helping the gypsies because that was the only way you could avoid criminal behavior among the gypsies. They would go about stealing and robbing if they had nothing to, no other way to make a living. So the municipal authorities were concerned to provide jobs for them, to provide occupation. And they did provide some way of outcome for their misery for the sake of reducing crime rate.
We have to stop.
Yeah.
April 27, 1998. I'm talking with Mr. Chakalov, and this is tape number 7. We were talking about the gypsies. Do you know of any private or privately organized ways to or efforts to help the gypsies?
No, there was no Bulgarian relief organization to speak of, no Bulgarian charities specifically oriented towards the gypsies. They were part of the efforts to help the underprivileged, not specifically set up for the gypsies. No, there was not such an organization.
At the time, were you aware, a part of the killing of the Nazi soldiers that you mentioned before, of resistance activities, underground activities against the Germans? And if so, who were those people that you came across?
Yes. You see, before the Germans attacked the Soviet Union, there was absolutely no resistance organized by the Bulgarian communists against the Germans. The Bulgarian communists, who organized the resistance against the Germans, it was purely a communist affair, started their resistance the moment the Germans attacked their second homeland, namely the Soviet Union. And with their international organization, their international links, they organized the Bulgarian communists into guerrilla groups, into a guerrilla movement, which was not very numerous, but it did exist, it did start existing. And this guerrilla movement fought not only the German presence, the German units in Bulgaria, but also Bulgarian police headquarters, even Bulgarian outposts, simply to mark some kind of activity. Now, those guerrilla bands were never more than 12 or 15 or 17 people. And they didn't operate in winter. They came back in winter. And they did, in material terms, they did very little harm to the Bulgarian economy.
Did you have any immediate personal contact with any of them?
Never as enemies, but some of them later on, as established, were had contacts with me in the following sense. I needed some timber. So I went and asked people whether they could procure the timber, and they found the timber for me. But these happened to be links to the guerrillas.
You needed the timber for which?
Personal purposes.
For personal purposes.
And these people knew that I was an officer. They were links to the guerrillas. The guerrillas actually felled the timber. And then they said, well, you were a nice chap. We liked you. And we enjoyed your company, even with guerrillas who in winter came to the towns. So these were my connections.
Well, what were your personal, not your official, but your personal thoughts about the communists and the communist underground in that period of time and in the context of what was happening around you?
I respected them for being brave. I respected them.
Other than that, did you think that they were doing?
They were misled. But they were brave, and they fought for ideas, mm-hmm. which were not mine. But they deserved respect.
Mm-hmm. I wanted to define something about the words we were talking before. You were talking about the gypsy quarters. Were there any Jewish quarters?
No.
In Sofia?
No.
Or in any cities of Bulgaria?
Let me think. Let me be precise. Let me be exact and true. I think that when they were sent away from Sofia, they may have been restricted to particular quarters in the provincial towns they went to. Mm-hmm. But I simply know of no such thing. There was nothing of the kind in Sofia or in any other town before they were. Before everybody left Sofia.
To your knowledge, is the word ghetto something that was used?
Non-existent in Bulgaria, for sure. Ghettos for the gypsies, yes. But I mean self-imposed ghetto. For the Jews, certainly not.
Okay. Next question. Your personal interaction with officials from Germany. Can you elaborate a little bit more than we did so far?
See, the situation, unfortunately, I have to be elaborate for 2 or 3 minutes. The situation with the Nazis and with Nazi Germany was not necessarily a black and white picture. Nazism allowed some spheres of public thinking in which he could express dissident opinion, just for the sake of letting the valve a little bit open.
Can you give me an example?
Say, for instance, I can give one particular case which is indicative. I was at a birthday party in a German office, which was composed of civilians mobilized in the army. So these were people who studied, people who spoke foreign languages. Some of them were with doctor's degrees. So that was. But they were all members of the Nazi party. Anyway, they were intellectuals as well. They were mobilized to try to break the codes of all sorts of communications that were intercepted in the Mediterranean. And to translate them from the respective foreign language. They did manage to break quite a few codes and to translate them from the respective language into German. That was a birthday party, and I remember even the names. Now,
who were those people?
The host was called Luft, L-U-F-T. One of the dramatis personae was Dr. Pöschel, P-O-E-S-H-S-C-H-L, Dr. Pöschel, a lawyer. And an Austrian of Hungarian descent, Bruno, that's clear, Dutz, D-U-T-Z. See, of course, it was a party where liquors were drunk. And now everybody wants to show that he's free, particularly those intellectuals. So they treaded on that semi-forbidden, semi-allowed zone of expressing personal opinion. And then Dr. Pöschel, was, among others, a very good pianist. And I ventured the view that I like Mendelssohn's piano compositions, which I do. And I asked him whether he liked them. He said, wonderful. Now, this was treading too much against German propaganda. So the host would have been, and I tell you this is a very interesting, the host would have been blamed for having allowed such a statement to be made in his home. So the host said, but he is a Jew. And it was easy for me to say, so what? I'm talking about the merit of musical compositions. So what? The unexpected reaction among these intellectual Nazis came from Bruno Dutz, the Austrian of Hungarian origin, who threw his glass at the portrait of Hitler. Apparently, alcohol consumption was not low at that point. And this was followed by several more glasses. And at that moment, I thought I will have to join in order to help the people who did that. It was also the Bulgarian officers who did the same. I threw my glass at Hitler's image as well. Then the party broke. That was too much. On the next day, everybody believed he did not remember anything. Everybody said, well, I was so cockeyed drunk after 11. After 11, I remember nothing. Imagine such a thing possible within a structure that was so apparently strong. I always reject these black and white pictures. Everybody is human. So that even such things were possible among the Germans.
How much did you socialize with them?
Was it deliberately or was it part of your duty? As little as possible. You see, I had to have an opinion about the characteristics of the important German people in Bulgaria, to know their weaknesses, to know just how they would behave under particular conditions. And this proved to be very useful when our king suddenly died in August 43. Then the Germans were a very dangerous factor in Bulgaria. They could have very easily attempted to take over the way they took over in Hungary. So I had to know each German just how he would react. I had to know what he was as a person so as to be able to predict his behavior under particular putative circumstances. So that's why I went there. It was no pleasure, to be sure, but I had to. Liaison officer.
King Boris, did you ever get to know him in person?
No, I never talked to him as person to person, but officially, he was well known to us through his opinions, through his views, which we tried to implement. So he was not an unknown person to me.
Were you in touch with anybody who was in his inner circle?
Yes.
Who yes. was that?
One of his advisors was Sevov, architect, S-E-V-O-V, architect Sevov. and I was more or less in collision with him. But I knew him. And
for which reason?
He abused, to my mind, on one particular occasion, he abused his public status as an advisor to the king for what I believe was his personal benefit. So I did something which I should have done. I exposed him, I went to him, we quarreled, and I said, you are not entitled to have two telephones in your office when people don't have telephones. He said, it's none of your business. This is precisely my business to see justice in this country done. And he said, I'm going to report you to the Minister of War, which he did, and the minister summoned me and said, you've done the right thing. Go on doing it the way you acted. So that was it.
What rank did you have at the time?
First lieutenant already, which was nothing impressive in a Ministry of War. I remained the very youngest officer of the ministry.
How do you see the role of King Boris within the political context towards the Nazis and his...
I have no words that can match the reality of his role. I mean, he is a Bulgarian saint. And I will make it a point to find a report by a physician from the Bulgarian Academy of Sciences, from the Institute of Physiology, who did a very interesting study into the causes of King Boris's death. We don't want to mingle in the personal affairs of the royal family. The royal princess Marie Louise lives here in New York, and I don't want to pressure her in her personal quest for the truth. But this report gave ample evidence or ample clues that he was murdered by the Germans. So,
in which way?
By their knowing his predisposition to certain ailments of the heart, and they, when he flew back from Berchtesgaden, they apparently gave him not the right amount of oxygen in the mask he wore, because it was an open plane. And since his return, he had never recovered and died 2 days later.
How old was he when he died?
About 50.
This medical report that you are referring to, the physician, in which, how much did he know the king was?
You see, he found a piece of the heart. Actually, a piece of the heart was found, a piece of the king's heart. And he managed...
Was that through autopsy?
Through autopsy, yes. See, the king's body was laid in state in the church for 7 days. And in order to keep it, that was in August, in order to keep it, they had to disembowel things. And although this was not allowed by the queen, who resented that, they had to do it. And the heart, including, was put in a glass container and was buried together with the king separately. Now the communists dug open the grave and they annihilated the remnants of the king. By some wonder, the jar with the heart remained. And the proof that this was the heart of the king stems from the fact that a section, a small portion of the heart was cut off by those who did the autopsy, the post-mortem. So the heart that was in the king's tomb was a heart with that section cut. So that was really the heart of the king.
Why would that section be cut?
For examination in the post-mortem by the physicians who did the post-mortem. They wanted to have a piece of the flesh of the heart to examine it. So that's not somebody else's heart. For one thing, it has to be proved. And then he examined what happened to that heart, and he has sufficient grounds to think that it was affected by inappropriate drugs being administered to the king by the Germans.
When was this report written?
This report was published 4 years ago. It couldn't have been done otherwise, because, see, the communists wouldn't allow anything to be said in favor of the king.
How old was the king's son, Simeon?
When the king died, King Simeon was 6. When he left Bulgaria, he was 8. He is now nearing 60. You cannot say that the king could have done anything better than what he did. I mean, it was such a difficult thing, because he was our national icon. He was not only, so with all our affection for him, with all our readiness to obey him, he was the person who had to bear the brunt of it all. And, well, there is no accurate proof, but there are certain clues which can lead people to think that he was administered drugs, and that the Germans knew what the weakness of his heart was, and they managed to provoke that hemorrhage which killed him.
Do you think that for the king, for the government, for the parliament, there would have been any way to go beyond that, what already was done by Bulgaria in its political interaction with Germany?
I think we could do better in Macedonia. I think we could have tried to do better in Macedonia and try to save the Bulgarians from Macedonia. I think we did not. I think we should have done better to try to save them. Because the police in Macedonia gave way, and it is a fact that the police in Macedonia, officially or not, helped in providing the addresses of the Jews to the Germans.
So those who then, in fact,
rounded
them up.
I'm not saying that officially. I'm not saying.
No.
It is my personal. I'm not the entire police, but parts of the police, I'm afraid.
So to round up the Jews, both in Thrace and in Macedonia, from your personal knowledge, who rounded the Jews up? Was that only the Germans?
Or? We could do nothing about the Jews in Thrace. If the Bulgarian police in Thrace, or the Bulgarian military authorities, were asked by the Germans to provide the addresses of the Jews, they had to do it.
Why?
Because they couldn't resist them, because of the overwhelming numbers of the German army there.
How does that compare to Macedonia?
I don't think that was a large-scale participation by Bulgarian police in helping the Germans, but there must have been cases when the police yielded to German pressure and helped them in finding where the Jews are. I think so. There must have been such cases. Our police was not up to the mark at that time. I'm afraid I have to admit that. Of course, the army units couldn't possibly be asked to do that, but I'm afraid the police gave in many cases. This is personal opinion. It is not acknowledged in Bulgaria. But I cannot say that the police did the best of job in this respect. Certainly not. Unfortunately, this is our blemish. Too bad.
Okay, we'll finish this tape. April 27, 1998, Mr. Chakalov, this is tape number 8. Your father, you told me, was a Freemason. Was that something that became less accepted during the Nazi years? How was it for your father to be a Freemason?
There was no interference in the Masonic movement, in the Masonic lodges during the Nazi eras. The Germans didn't go that far, couldn't go that far in Bulgaria. The lodges operated normally. They were closed down by the communists after that. There was absolutely no interference. Nobody suffered for having been a Mason, but by the communists. The king himself was a Mason. Many respected people were Masons. That was it.
You were a liaison between Bulgaria and the Germans. Do you recall an incident where this being between the two was especially hard?
It was only hard, and no pleasure coming out of it, even at banquets and at birthday parties. But the particularly hard moments were when the king died and I sensed movement among the Germans. That would have been my horrible responsibility if I were unable to learn about some plots, some plot being engineered by the Germans to take over the government. And under these conditions, I relied on personal friendships with individual Germans.
For example?
I must tell you, I also exercised threat. Particularly with one person who was operating a teletype machine, who I knew.
What was his
was,
name?
I might not be able to remember that name.
In which, what was his official title or what?
He was
which position was he acting at the time?
Senior. A junior sergeant, junior sergeant. He was a military man, junior sergeant.
And where was he based?
I knew where he lived. He lived in the same apartment store where I lived. You see? So he was more or less a member of mine, neighbor of mine. And I used to tell him, now, if I complain of your behavior here, if I complain to your very high authorities and say you abused a Bulgarian or you came home drunk or anything of that kind, you would suffer for it. You would be sent to the front. I'm sorry to say that I extorted things from this man for the sake of my country because he received the messages. And as a matter of fact, I did not extort him, but he simply presented himself as a person eager to help me. You see, when you are a lieutenant and you are very considerate to a junior sergeant, he is flattered. We had drinks at home, my neighbor. So once he came to my place drunk and he said, Lieutenant, I don't know. I thought he wanted to tell me something, but he dared not. You know, he stuck to the military discipline of standing erect, but he was drunk. I said, it's a pity things are going too bad between Bulgaria and Germany. I'm so sorry. So I really thought he had some secret on his mind. And I immediately took advantage of his desire to be my subordinate in rank and his drunken situation. I said, now, get it out of your system and tell me what it is all. I said, very sorry, but there is an order which concerns you. That was in April 44, that you must be killed should we retreat from here because you refuse to join us upon a possible retreat. I said, thank you very much. It's grand. I congratulate you. But I threatened him and said, well, if you don't tell me exactly what things is, I can do some harm to you. And in a week, you will be shooting behind your machine gun at the front. So I said, there is an order that a certain German unit is responsible for not leaving you behind the German lines if the Germans should retreat. And they made an attempt, they shot at me. Well, these were already the 44. I was shot at while returning in a car, in an open car. So what I did was...
Returning from where to where?
From Sofia to my place where I lived outside of Sofia, mm-hmm. when Sofia was bombed out. So that was really serious.
Do you have any... Do you know who shot
no.
at you?
I knew the... the particular organization which was entrusted with that. It was a detachment of young Germans of 18, 19 or 20 years, soldiers, who were very inspired with their physical capacities. The Germans say Draufgangers, you see Draufgangers. And I knew that they were the ones. So the way I rejected was again in a casual talk with their bosses to tell them that, well, I was shot at by a German, by somebody from a German car. And I said, well, certainly that must have been some stupid accident, maybe a girl involved. But I'm very sorry, I have to tell you that my friends in the war office take that very seriously. And should something happen with me, I take no responsibility for the retaliation that you will see from Bulgarian officers. Nothing happened more. Only at the last day, before they left, when I was accompanying the very last detachments of the German Nazis, seeing them off from Bulgaria, having declared war on them, starting on the next day at 6 o'clock, you allowed them to get, if they could, get back from it. That they made yet another attempt to kill me. Because of that stupid idea of all military men, that when you retreat, you have to leave a burned up land behind you. A land that contains nothing of use. So they thought that God knows what information I would be able to give to the Russian soldiers that invaded Bulgaria after they left. So that was the stupid way of simplifying things. We cannot leave anybody like that behind. Of course, they promised I would retain my rank, I would be high position in the German army. But this was inconceivable. It was just one of the worst things that a Bulgarian could do, to tarnish his country. So these were relations. It wasn't easy.
In 43, there seems to have been once a demonstration that was a demonstration to oppose the sanctions that started to be imposed on the Jewish population. Do you know anything about that demonstration?
You mean a demonstration in Sofia?
Yeah.
Yes, there was one.
Do you have any immediate knowledge about that?
No, I do not have, and this was not much talked about. Apparently it was maybe less than you think it was. It couldn't have involved too many people. I know, I now remember there was one, maybe two of that kind, but nothing spectacular to my mind.
Do you know about any detention camps or other camps for Jews, be they Bulgarian or foreign Jews, within the then borders of Bulgaria?
I do not know of any specialized detention camp for Jews. I know of detention camps. I know of camps of forced labor, but not of Jewish camps. I should have known, were there any. I really do not know. I should have known if there were some.
So the camps that you know about, what kind of, who was in those camps?
They were the camps of communists, of people who were suspected that they would go in the woods. They were simply taken by the police and were put somewhere. Among them, there could
by the Bulgarian police
by the Bulgarian police. By the Bulgarian police. Just how many these camps were? How many people were there in it? In them? They were usually at big construction sites, such as dam construction, that got these unwanted people dumped together with their legal rights neglected. Now you stay here and you work here because you're a drunkard, because you broke through somebody's homes, the police doesn't like you, here is your place.
Do you have any names of these places that you recall?
Let me not make a mistake with the numerous subsequent camps which Gonda Voda, that was for communists, potential guerrillas. The police did that. I'm not very well informed about this.
Do you know if the Germans were at all involved?
No, not in any capacity. Maybe you have noticed that I'm not very proud of the Bulgarian police.
So you told me before, let's go back into the sequence of things that happened, that the Germans prepared for pulling
withdrawing,
back,
yes.
For withdrawing. Can you elaborate a little bit more what happened?
Yes, it was in a way interesting because there were no official statements, I should have known if there were some, by the Bulgarian authorities that we want the Germans to withdraw. It was the success of the Soviet armies in Romania, north of Bulgaria, that apparently posed the decision on the German high command to withdraw from Bulgaria because that was a very uncertain country. And without any particular notice on our part, though there were intimation, all right, it would be fair, it would be okay for you, we assume that you would withdraw under these conditions, what do you think is the best solution for you, such kind of things. They began withdrawing until on the 5th of September 1944, they had withdrawn practically all their troops from Bulgaria. So the Minister of War summoned the remaining highest ranking officer of the German army in Bulgaria. He was Lieutenant General von Trotta, T-R-O-T-T-A, to the Ministry of War in my presence, and informed him that as of 6 hours on the next day, Bulgaria has decided to be at war with Germany, a war against Germany. So he advised the colonel that there would be relations of peace between Bulgaria and Germany only until 6 o'clock next morning. Now, just how much that was fair, how much that was unfair, it's another matter. Technicalities are technicalities. So there were still many German troops retreating along the... It was only then that we found out how many Germans were in Bulgaria, retreating along the main routes towards Serbia. And the situation got out of control. Bulgarian soldiers shot at the Germans. I mean, it was the state was not in good order.
Where were you? Did you remain in Sofia all the
yes,
time?
Yes, all the time in Sofia. So
your information came in
oh
via
yes,
telegraph, or how did you?
Information came by wireless from the army units. So. A very interesting agreement was reached at that point, by virtue of which the German High Command in Berlin authorized in writing Lieutenant Colonel von Trotter to issue orders to any German officer, be he a general, on behalf of the High Command. This is very rare practice within the army. And it read, in connection with an agreement reached with the Bulgarian government, Colonel von Trotter has the right to issue orders to any German officer in implementation of that agreement, full stop. I had the same authorization from the general staff, that Lieutenant so-and-so had the right to issue order to Bulgarian commanding officers in connection with an agreement with the German High Command. So we went in a car, and under the terms of this agreement, had a fusillade started, exchange of fire started between unauthorized Bulgarian troops and German troops receiving, we were entitled to disarm, no matter who was to blame, to disarm the German troops so that later on, even if they were fired, there would be no skirmishes, and they would continue and probably reach the frontier safely. We were in the inverse situation with our corps of occupation in Serbia, which was returning to Bulgaria under German fire. So we went in a car with Colonel von Trotter, and whenever I decided that German unit had to be disarmed because there was already a skirmish between, I said, unauthorized Bulgarian soldiers. The aim was not to fire the Germans. The aim was to get them out. I asked him to order the delivery of all arms, and they were disarmed. That was a peculiar experience, and it was on that day that he showed me his car. His luggage was arranged only behind his seat, and behind my seat in front was empty. He said, this is for your luggage. I said, Colonel, it's a last-ditch attempt, but it won't work. I'm staying here. But you will be killed by the Russians. Well, he said, you're not a prophet. It's my business. And then, when I got out of the car, a German motorcycle with its sidecar attempted to execute the orders of the German High Command, ran me over, broke my leg.
Deliberately, you think?
Deliberately. And it was too bad because all three soldiers were shot by Bulgarians after that, which they shouldn't have done. I mean, these people were executing orders.
Do you know who they were?
Oh, no, no. I'm just somebody. Oh, particularly at that moment.
Where exactly did it happen?
That happened the area of the skirmishes was between 75 and 35 kilometers to the east of Sofia on the road towards Plovdiv. That was the troublesome area. It was a time when we served without real orders. Bulgaria had already fallen apart, prey to the communists, because on the same day when we expelled the Germans, the Soviet Union declared war on Bulgaria. So it was all a turmoil.
What were your thoughts for expectations? What would happen next?
I had no idea.
Did you have hopes?
Not much. Not much reason to hope.
What happened?
What happened?
After you broke your leg?
We returned to the war ministry in the evening. I returned. Actually, breaking a leg is not the worst thing that can happen. You can move about. It all depends how it is broken. With the help of crutches.
Can you give a date to the day when your leg was broken?
The 5th of September, 1944. Anyway, see how it is healed. That was a very crucial thing because, as I said, practically all the ministers were in the office of my chief, head of intelligence, to see just what the situation is.
What was the
His
name?
Of, yeah. Colonel Tumbin, T-U-M-B-I-N, one of the people who immediately lost their lives. And then we got a message that since Bulgaria was de facto co-belligerent on the next day with the Allies, that was the day at which we were at war with everybody in the world. At war with everybody in the world. Since we became co-belligerents, an U.S. mission of four people from the Office of War Information in Istanbul was heading towards our general staff to establish liaison. Again, liaison. So I was out of my job for only one day on the 6th when I could bandage my leg and cope with a very high fever resulting from this. So I became the liaison officer of the War Ministry with an American mission on the 7th of September.
Who appointed you?
The War Minister. Oh, actually, the Chief of Staff. Because I was the liaison officer of the War Ministry. Now start liaison work with an American mission.
The Chief of Staff's name was, do you remember?
General Jan Chulev, YANCHOULEV.
And what did you do?
So I welcomed the Americans and said, now we would like to offer you every 2 hours, because the general staff immediately became supreme command of the Bulgarian army. We were at war, officially at war. So every 2 hours you will get from us a map with the position of our troops on the front. so that your planes shall not attack our positions. We are fighting your enemies.
Who were you interacting with?
Yes,
the American
charming person by the name of Harry H. Harper, whose widow I saw when I came here again. Harry H. Harper. Harry is Harry. H-E-R-P-E-R, who was at that time associate editor of the Reader's Digest and remained the editor of Reader's Digest for nearly 20 years. And
any other?
Oh, yes. That was first lieutenant. And then there was a second lieutenant, Dean, Dean, D-E-A-N, Woodruff, W, not O-U, but W-U, D-R-O-U-G-H, Dean Woodruff. And Nate Schiffman, N-A-T-E, S-H-I-F-F-M-A-N. And the fourth, I remember only his second name, Buck, B-U-C-K.
And we have to stop here.